was predicted by that guy at Oakland named Harold Jenkins for Saturday, May 21st, 2011, and then again on Friday, October 21st. Both of those dates passed very peacefully then, and the radio evangelist was apparently quite embarrassed that his calculations for the end of the world had been wrong. Well, actually, the end of the world did come on Friday, March 2nd, 2 days ago. As I lay upside down in the dentist chair for the first time in, let's say, several years, I thought it was all over. I mean, all over. And my entire life began to flash before my eyes as the world came to an end. I recall all the mean things I ever said. I obsessed whether I left the cap off the toothpaste. And I worried that maybe I had not put enough money in the parking meter. But since the world was coming to an end, at least for me, I thought, well, did I mention that it was painful? The disarming thing, of course, was that the dentist was very personable, even gracious and kind to me. He kept asking me because it was okay. Probably because the back of my head was slammed into the back of the chair behind me, kind of like a meteorite that had slammed into a crater so far. And my fists were turning red from the nails, fingernails, pressing into the palm of my hand. And did I mention it was painful? Well, somehow, after 2 hours of cleaning and repairs, I was miraculously back on planet Earth and alive. And then I remembered that the parking was free because I was in the parking. Well, I owe it all to this experienced dentist who was genuinely concerned that he was not pushing me, you know, too far, causing me completely unbearable. This crosses my mind. Each week I worry about pushing you too far. Obviously, the good news of the gospel doesn't always strike you as good, and many of you are slammed into the back of the church as far away from the pulpit as you can get. It's important to stay away from the pain of being drilled from up here. But honestly, a sermon is not a root canal. I mean, it's a survival event, and it's over. But the horror of all this flashed before my eyes again when I read the gospel for this morning. This passage in which Jesus and his number one disciple, Peter, get into a real argument about where Jesus is going and whether his disciples are going to follow him. Only moments before, in the verses just above this passage, Peter made this amazing statement of faith, telling Jesus that he believed that he was God's Messiah. Peter was so convinced that Jesus was God's anointed one that he was willing to follow him and give complete allegiance and obedience. So when Jesus picked up on that testimony of faith, it was almost as if the world was coming to an end right then and there. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. All this Jesus says quite openly. Mark's gospel tells us this at least, but Peter took his Lord and his Messiah aside privately and rebuked the Lord's anointed one, the Christ, the Son of God, to whom his disciple has given his complete unswerving faith. Peter says, no! No! Matthew's telling the story even more dramatic, and it says that Peter took him God forbid, Lord, this shall never happen to you. It's understandable that the disciple would want to avert, you know, harm for his master to whom he'd given all of his devotion. It was like the world was coming to an end. He said it was a horrible prediction, an unthinkable turn of events. This must never happen. But then what does happen is even more unbelievable. Get behind me. You are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. So I think that this is kind of a double whammy of the worst sort for Peter. First, that his master and his Lord was going to die. Jesus is suggesting that the loyal disciple is tempting or testing his Lord to see if he will learn, to see if he will what? To see if he'll back down in his obedience to God and just avoid the coming confrontation and conflict that would undoubtedly trigger suffering and rejection. The temptation is to back away from anything that's risky that might cause suffering for us. Jesus characterizes his tempter as Satan. Because Peter, the tempter, cannot imagine that Jesus would take the way voluntarily of suffering. He should look for the easy way to stay away from rejection and death. You are setting your mind not on the body, but on you. Now that really hurts. That really hurts Peter in the story, and I think it hurts us too, my friends. It hurts our feelings as disciples in our own kinds, you know, because it implies that it's human to avoid suffering and rejection and death. In fact, the evil Satan and Almighty God are engaged in this kind of cosmic battle. And it's human to want no part of it, to avoid conflict of all sorts. We're thinking this over, aren't we? Every Lent, we're faced with the unacceptable, the unthinkable fact that Jesus chose the way of suffering when he was tempted to dodge it. And in case we think that there's some, you know, acceptable middle ground for Christians where we can just, you know, love God, belong to Christ, and still hibernate comfortably with a remote control and a whole full of power, you know, and just watch this cosmic battle on high def or in 3D, but the second paragraph of today's reading really is unmistakably clear. This is not the case. We can't do that as Christians. If anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow. In other words, make no mistake, following Jesus is high risk. Do not compromise. The divine way is likely to end in suffering. Rejection and death. We're only human if we're looking for some wiggle room here, aren't we? What does it mean to take up our cross, after all? I mean, can't we just tease the pastor that's sitting through that sermon again with, like, burying our cross? What does it mean to be disciples in our times? Lord, would it be enough if we volunteered both for coffee hour and for prayer? I mean, isn't that enough cross to bear? Or would we put $2 in the collection plate today? Enough? But I don't stand by that it's our ultimate wiggle room as human beings and disciples. We just say, well, nobody's perfect. Nobody is perfect, which is why God sent the Savior. Jesus is very aware that the human things are the sinful things, and humans need redemption. In fact, right here, Jesus refers to the people of his own generation as adulterous and sinful. And human nature has to But before we think now that Jesus is going on a godly rant about adultery and other sexual sins, it should be clear what he means. Adulterous is a frequent metaphor, picture language in the scripture for unfaithfulness to God. It's adultery against God to have an affair with other gods, to jump into bed with other values, with human ways that are not. Okay, like the dentist, I'm going to slack off a minute. How are we doing here? You okay? Not too painful? You hear Jesus shouting back at us, get behind me, all you saints who tempt the godly to take the easy way, the shortcut, the windy path of no resistance. What do you make of this? Jesus predicts suffering for himself. And then he explains that his disciples will suffer their own. Is suffering really, a part of that Christian minimum that we have to do that? Is rejection and death part of what we signed up for when we said, I believe in God? I'm trying to break this to you easy, my friends. I mean, for many people, just getting up on Sunday morning is cross to do. Leaving the Sunday paper unread or your latte is half drunk. But people of our times really encounter suffering. They not only avoid it at all costs, they present it as suffering. existence, our lack of strength, and despite our appetite just for pleasure, our avoidance of all pain. I say this as a human being, too. I mean, I didn't go to the dentist for far too long because I, too, prefer to avoid pain and inconvenience. Why, then, is there a cross in human growth? Why did Jesus have to die? Most direct answer to that age-old question, of course, is that he didn't have to die. He was human beings who built that cross, who crafted it as an excruciating form of execution. It was human beings who falsely accused Jesus and dragged him before human authorities to get complicity with his murder. He didn't have to die, but human beings made sure that he did. Well, where is God in all of this? If God is all-powerful, why did God let this terrible tragedy of suffering and rejection and death unfold as it did? Peter shouted at his Lord, "No! God forbid it, Lord! This must never happen to you." Why did God let it happen? The Bible's answer to this age-old question is, I didn't have to start with it. You must realize that if you ask a question wrong, the answer is worthless. If you don't ask the right question, you do not get the right answer. And I think that's the case here. It's out of whack to say, well, why did God let Jesus die? The answer reminds us of the question. God was in Christ. Jesus is Lord, Son of God, only begotten. It is God in Jesus Christ who was crucified, dying in prayer. God did not let Jesus die. God in Jesus died at human hands or human beings. God accepted what we dish out in our ignorance or stubbornness or our selfishness. That's the true answer, my friends, that God has died on the cross for us. And now is the question to be revised. For me, I thought it was, you know, like something I'm going to want of thought to, and the current illustration of the game of Jeopardy came to my mind. The answer is there, and I have to come up with a question. Isn't that the way they play the game? They give you the answer, but you have to think, well, what's the question that fits? So my question is, what must I do as a disciple of Jesus living today to prevent God being killed over and over today? What can I do to stop the killing, to stop the pain, to somehow come between those who suffer and those who cause the suffering? There are causes, my friends. There are causes to follow Jesus. But the world does not come to an end when you decide to follow Jesus. If you ask these questions in your heart of hearts, if you follow Jesus and you're willing to risk the cost, you will actually upgrade from being an admirer to being a disciple. And what you give up, what you lose, is not important. Because what you